you.
Radio you can touch.
This is the Bob and Jeff Show, starring Bob Lutz.
Who the hell are you? I'd rather go down to the barber shop and ask a guy about ready to get his hair cut what the urgency's like.
Lord knows we need family now more than ever.
Jeff Lutz.
I just don't want to indulge you, and I'm the greatest thing in the world every time we're on the show. I'm not going to do that.
You're unbelievable. Judas.
97.5 and 1240 KFH.
It's showtime, baby. You'll go wacko, bananas, nuts, crazy, unbelievable.
Are you ready? Let's go!
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Friday edition, the Bob and Jeff Show on KFH Radio. Bob Lutz, Jeff Lutz, co-hosting. Max Power, producing, engineering, 869-1240. That's the IHOP hotline as we conclude a week with a beautiful weather day outside.
Have you been out
to enjoy it?
Not yet.
Why not?
Just haven't.
What have you been doing all morning?
Resting up for a long night.
A long night down
probably.
At KWC8.
Yeah, big week.
What time you normally get out of there on a Friday?
11:30-ish, maybe a little later.
Well, an exciting night of high school football, the final night of the regular season, although they call this district play. I'm confused about all of it. I just want to see what happens next week when North High gets to visit Washburn Rural.
Well, this isn't district play for everybody.
I know that. I'm saying that next week when they put them into seeds, North High will face Washburn Rural.
Yep.
And North has to do this every year. It's above and beyond punitive. And I'm going to get angry about it.
Well, it is pretty ridiculous, but this is the way the system is set up right now. It's flawed at best, but I don't know. I don't know why they changed it to you get to play your nine and then your top two go. That made perfect sense to me, but they said everybody's going to get in the playoffs
now. I liked it back when we had true districts where you tallied up the points, and it was fun. We worked on that feverishly at the Wichita Eagle.
Well, we'll be doing that tonight at Catch at Kansas. Our boy Hendo, the preeminent probably bracket expert,
but just
I would
in
say.
4A and 3A.
But we'll have the brackets out. What do you mean 4A and 3A?
Yeah, we'll look at it.
2A.
Yeah, but yeah, we'll look at it.
6A.
We'll look at it.
They're all there.
I'll certainly go to my source for high school athletics.
Well, you need to go to Catch at Kansas because we'll have the brackets.
Well, I may have another source that I like.
I would hope not.
Well, you never know. I got a lot of sources.
Well, you don't need a lot. You need one, and we got it.
I'll be paying attention. I'll be paying attention to baseball. Two more games on the docket. Well, Houston's just steamrolling Texas now. I don't know. Don't know what the Rangers can do.
Well, we'll see what happens now that they're back around to Montgomery.
Are they back around to Montgomery?
I thought so.
I think they are. Is it Montgomery and Verlander tonight?
I'm pretty sure that's the matchup. And then Eovaldi and Valdez, I would assume, would be game six.
It's a must-win for Texas.
No, it's not.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and sit with that. Because momentum has shifted tremendously.
What has? I don't want to get into that.
Oh, well, yesterday it was, well, he's, what was it you said?
Jordan Montgomery
wants it more.
I believe that.
I'll take momentum over he wants it more any day of the week.
Ah, okay.
Meanwhile, Christopher Sanchez and Joe Mantiply starting for the Phillies and Diamondbacks. In a pure bullpen game. You know, back in my day, you know what we had?
Uh-uh.
We had starters going on short rests in key games like this.
Well, that's great. That's just awesome. Why don't we ruin a pitcher's career? That's a great idea to do that.
Well, it's better than Christopher Sanchez, who I've never even heard of, and Joe Mantiply, who was an all-star last year, but he couldn't get an out this year. What are we doing?
Well, we're going to the bullpens and seeing how that turns out. Yesterday was classic in Arizona. That game was fantastic, and
you
Arizona
agree with
pulls it off.
Flat out?
Fott, you mean?
Whatever his name is. A lot of debate.
He probably would have gone six. He went five and two-thirds.
All your 30-ish baseball analytics guys who last
30-ish. You know that there are older guys that actually adapt and
who last threw something when they threw a rock in the lake. That's my point.
So pretty recently.
Yeah. When they were 8 or 9. Now they pretend to know everything. They couldn't play their way out of a paper sack.
They're not supposed to play. They're supposed to analyze what's happening, and part of analyzing what's happening is getting inside the dugout, understanding the decisions are made, understanding why the decisions are made, and understanding
even
the tools.
Torrey Lovullo thought, "What am I doing here?" He even admitted it.
He said he questioned it.
Yeah, am I an idiot
still
for doing this? He did it because some guy came in from the clubhouse. And pulled on his jersey and said, "Mr. Lovullo, my stats tell me
The manager's decision.
We should take him out of the game because if he faces Kyle Schwarber again for the third time, Schwarber's liable to hit a home run.
Why do you think that's funny? I mean, you're supposed to – I thought you liked baseball. So what do you hate it? Why do you hate it?
Why are you so upset with
because
me?
Because I thought you liked baseball. You're just John Smoltz. Oh, why is he doing this? This would never happen. And when I played. Nobody cares, John, and nobody cares, Bob. This is 2023. This is the game.
With a pocket protector should not be making
key
decisions.
Then why do these guys get hired? You don't think Mike Hazen's a good general manager? You don't think that he surrounds himself with smart people? And you don't think Torrey Lovullo's part of that team?
Listen, they brought in the left-hander with two outs to face Schwarber, and he walked him. What if the next guy cranks a homer? Then what are we saying today? Tell me.
We're not, because he didn't.
No, but tell me what we would be saying. Because the guy that was brought in to face Schwarber, from the guy, you know, "Hey, Mr. Lovullo," he walked Schwarber.
So now you disrespect the manager because you don't think he can make his own decisions.
No, he doesn't get to.
Yes, he does.
He's ordered by the front office.
No, he's not. He absolutely is not ordered.
So please answer my question. What would we be saying today had the two-hole hitter for the Phillies, who is that, by the way? Who batted second for them yesterday?
Is it Turner?
Yeah. I think so. What if he had cranked a home run?
Then we're having a different conversation, but we're not. And Arizona won the ball game. You know what? Philadelphia went with convention and brought their closer in the bottom of the ninth inning. And what happened? Lost. Sometimes convention and conventional thinking can turn on you. Sometimes unconventional.
Well, that was the right move. Nobody questioned bringing Kimbrel in.
That's what I'm saying. It was the right move, but it did not work.
Right.
So what's the difference?
Well, to make the right move that works. That's what you do.
Well, I feel like Arizona did that.
The decision to bring the left-hander in didn't work because the left-hander walked the hitter he was brought in to face. And then he had to face the right-hander.
Well, Kyle Schwarber walks a lot.
Right. You can't walk him. You know what I'm saying.
He has good at-bats.
You know I'm right.
No, you're not right.
Here's what we have on tap for the show today. And we'll get back to this age-old argument of analytics versus knowing what's going on.
It's not analytics.
At 2:45 today. Wait a minute. Is that right? Yeah, I think it is. Steve Martin, the head football coach. People got excited there for a minute.
Oh, I did.
I could feel it. Are you watching Only Murders in the Building?
We watched a couple episodes.
It's really good.
We should probably keep watching it.
It's really good. And we enjoy it here. So Steve Martin, head football coach at Wichita Northwest, they face Manhattan tonight in a huge game in Class 6A. And will be our guest. At 3 o'clock, Drew Dallas, the head football coach of number one ranked Hutchinson Community College, will join the show from his offices over at Hutch.
Yep.
And what's wrong with you today?
I would assume so. Where else would he be?
Well, I want to give it a little pizzazz. I want to give the intro a little from his office over in Hutch.
How do you know that's where he'll be?
Because he told me. And at 3:25, Joanna Chadwick from Vibe Magazine will talk about all the good high school games tonight. I want to ask her about something I just read on Twitter. They've moved the South and West game to Goddard-Eisenhower because of damage to South High.
Vandalism.
Vandalism to the stadium?
I guess.
What kind of morons? What is going on? What's the vandalism?
I don't know. I've been looking at a couple emails from at Channel 12, my inbox, and I don't really know, but there's something going on at South.
I'd like more information about that.
Well, let me see if I can find more information.
And then at 3:40, we have five questions with?
Don't know. Waiting on a yes from somebody.
You know, nail this down earlier in the week. How do you live on this?
I didn't think I was doing the show today.
Well, you would still be responsible.
No, I would
for
not.
Five questions.
I would absolutely not.
Yes, you absolutely would.
You take the day
would.
Off, I'm off.
You ought to have five questions nailed down Monday of every week.
Absolutely not.
I don't wait until the last minute to get these guests lined up.
Okay, well, I did not think I was doing the show today. And when I take a day off, I'm off. I'm not booking the show when I'm off.
That is the height of laziness right there. That kind of talk just irritates the heck out of me. No allegiance to the show at all. When I'm off, I'm off. You guys can sink or swim.
That's
doesn't
pretty much
it. Doesn't matter to me. Doesn't matter to me what happens to the show.
Doesn't.
Really?
Right.
On the days you're off, you don't care about this show.
No. Just like you don't. You don't help
I
out.
I care about
you don't help
show.
Out on the days that I'm off. You're,
of course I do.
You don't even listen. You don't participate.
Of course I help out.
You don't
out.
Care.
That's crazy.
No, it's not.
Well, we'll see how you hold up next week when I'm not here.
I'll be fine.
This show will be a train wreck.
I've already got a booking.
But who do you have?
Darby Allin.
Really?
Yeah.
What day is that?
I think Thursday.
Huh. Well, you'll be with Duda on Thursday. And then the following week, after that, we have author Roland Lazenby and comedian Aaron Weber.
All right.
All and, coming up on this show.
And perhaps something else.
Well, we'll see.
We'll see.
We'll see if it comes to fruition or not.
It probably will.
869-1240. If you would like to get on the show today, we would welcome you. Astros, as I said, with a resounding win over Texas last night. Texas kind of came back, was in that game, and then Mr. Who was it that got the big hit yesterday?
I don't
help,
know.
Help a
to
guy
be honest,
out.
I was hanging out with the kid again.
You were not watching the ball game?
I watched some of it, but I didn't see all of it.
What were you doing with the kid?
We went out to dinner because, you know, she has rehearsal all week, and her mother was doing conferences and working late, so we went out to Olive Garden. It was good.
And you didn't watch the ball game?
I watched the Philadelphia one. Missed a lot of the other.
It was Jose Abreu with the
big a long
blow.
Home run.
With the big blow, and he's starting to – well, they just got – they're relentless.
That's Houston
like
for you.
I Astros, but I respect them.
Why don't you like them?
Because they cheated.
20 years ago, and none of those guys are even on the team
Altuve
anymore.
Altuve and Bregman are.
Altuve didn't cheat.
I got some land I'd like to talk to you about. If you do you remember the scene of Altuve not wanting his jersey?
Yes, who ripped? Big deal.
Do you remember that?
That's just a solution looking for a problem. That's just we'll take this evidence.
Have you ever seen
and
that?
Match it to this idea.
Have you ever seen? You've seen a guy.
Yeah, don't mess with my hair. Don't
what,
hit me. Don't
what other
hit
player
me.
Has?
Oh, I've seen it. Lonnie,
give me an example.
Lonnie Chisenhall used to
Lonnie
do it.
Lonnie Chisenhall.
Yeah, guys run away right when they're.
But they're playing and then you.
But
catch
they still
him.
Run away.
Ketel Marte did that yesterday. They caught him. They ripped his. Whatever they ripped. Yeah, people don't do that unless they're hiding something. That guy had more wires on him than.
So I doubt it.
I don't know.
That seems pretty elaborate. But what do I know?
He sure seemed very adamant about. Don't
why is
you,
he still awesome?
Don't you dare rip my shirt.
Why is he still awesome?
Because he doesn't need to cheat.
He didn't cheat. All that, the evidence said that he was one of the people who said, I don't want this.
Why did the others cheat?
Because they wanted it, I guess.
I do like Dusty Baker. I don't mind a lot of the Astros, but they just got a winning mentality. And
right, they win every year.
And I'd love to be able to match that somehow. The Cardinals win every year for the most part, but they don't win at this level.
No, nobody does. It's pretty. It's not a totally.
Are you envious
impressive.
Of the Cardinals?
No, not envious of anybody.
As a Guardians fan,
I wouldn't change it for the world. Love being a Guardians fan.
You don't envy the fact that all these teams get to the postseason and win. And
we've
do,
been to the postseason a bunch.
And do
I would
things.
Love to win a World Series. We have a 75-year drought, but it'll end within the next century or so.
Who wins tonight? Montgomery or Verlander? Astros or Rangers?
Probably the Astros.
So they'll sweep the series in Texas.
Yeah.
And they'll go home, and then what?
Go seven. They'll win in seven.
They'll win in seven.
Yeah.
Even though Philadelphia will have Wheeler at home set
I
to go.
I thought we were
again.
Talking about Houston and Texas.
Oh. Yeah, even though Texas will have
Eovaldi.
Eovaldi. And Houston will have Franmer Valdez.
Yeah, I think Texas wins that game and forces a game seven.
What happens in Arizona today in the bullpen game?
I don't know. It could be 1-0. It could be 12-11. You have no idea what's going to happen.
It's going to be high scoring.
Probably.
In my opinion. And then, if the Diamondbacks were to win, then you got to face Wheeler tomorrow with Gallen. And Wheeler is... Hang with me here. I think Zach Wheeler's the best pitcher in baseball. And then you're
really?
Yeah, I really do. And you're trying to really hard to think of something to refute.
Well, Garrett Cole.
No, I like Wheeler better.
Okay.
I think he's the best pitcher in baseball, and I think he has been for a while.
Blake Snell?
Nope. Wheeler better. Goes deeper. Just a stud. And then Aaron Nola's not far behind that.
You hope.
Why?
Because you think he's going to be a Cardinal.
Well, I don't know that he's going to be a Cardinal. I think they're going to try to improve their pitching. I mean, some of these guys got to be a Cardinal, or they might as well check it in.
Shane Bieber for Lars Nootbaar.
No, we're not doing that.
Why?
Because I like Lars Nootbaar. I mean,
they don't. They don't play him that often.
They play him all the time when he's healthy. He's in the lineup every day.
Well, we'll take him.
He needs to be a Cardinal, and he's helping recruit right now that Japanese pitcher. He and Nolan Arenado made a trip over to Japan.
Well, looks
to
like
watch
the,
that kid pitch.
Looks like the Giants are really in on him, too.
We'll beat the Giants out. You know, do what we need to do. Nootbaar is apparently a very close friend of the kids.
Well, he did play for Team Japan. In
would
the World Baseball Classic.
Would you bring Yadier Molina in to be the bench coach if you were the Cardinals?
Yes.
Even though...
That undermines your manager?
Might think, oh, my God. Which he would think.
Well, then do better.
But how do you not have friction between those two if you do that?
Well, maybe you will. I don't know. I doubt there would be internal friction as much as external.
And Cardinal Nation would just as soon you bring Yachty in as manager.
Right.
Why don't they just do that?
They should. They should have, you know, I don't know if you wait a year for Mike Schilt and then make the change because Molina was still playing under Marmol. But she should have been the next manager of the team.
All right, we'll take a break. When we come back, we'll talk some more about all this. The Bob and Jeff Show, KFH.
KFH.
All right, we are back. It's I, Me, Mine week. I Feel Free from Cream. What are you snickering about?
I didn't. I sniffled.
I thought I heard you snicker.
No, I sniffled.
Well, don't sniffle into the microphone.
Why not?
It's okay to snicker.
Well, maybe I did snicker, but I didn't.
So we've got a full NFL slate. We haven't talked about the NFL a whole lot this week. Somebody asked me the other day, you hanging in there with your Raiders? Which I said,
my Raiders? That's what you should have said.
To which I said, And then I look and they're 3-3. Now, they're not any good. But right. They've won a couple games in a row, and they have some personnel. What does that mean?
They have two personnel.
No, they have.
They got Crosby, and they got Devontae Adams.
And they've got Josh Jacobs. And they've got And they've got Jacoby Myers, who's done very well for me on my fantasy team.
Well, I'm happy to hear that.
And they've got a developing rookie tight end in Michael Meyer. They're not terrible. They shouldn't be terrible. And
they're average.
By golly, they're going to win this week to go to 4-3.
Who do they have?
The Bears.
Well, you would hope so.
Bears without Justin Fields. Then they have the Lions, 4-4. The Giants at home, 5-4. The Jets at home, that's a toss-up.
They'll lose.
That's a toss-up. At the Dolphins, Chiefs.
5-7.
Gets tougher. But after the Chiefs, they got the Vikings, the Chargers, the Colts, the Broncos. They'll finish something like 8-9 or 9-8, and that'll be it.
I doubt they finish 9-8, but we'll see. I would not bet on them finishing with a winning record. But who knows?
Couldn't they go 6-5 against the Bears, Lions, Giants, Jets, Dolphins, Chiefs, Vikings, Chargers, Chiefs, Colts, Broncos?
Maybe. 5-6 sounds...
They'll do something like that.
Yeah, it'll be right around 500. I have a question for you. You're the Chicago Bears, and you get Carolina's first-round pick, which right now is number one. The Bears are basically lining up to be number two. You have the top two picks in the draft. What is your course of action if you're the Chicago Bears?
I still believe in Justin Fields.
So you're not taking Caleb Williams and Marvin Harrison?
You'd be tempted to. You'd definitely take Marvin Harrison. But I still believe in Justin Fields. I'd take Harrison and a defensive player.
Isn't... Their
if
coach
I were the Bears.
Ain't going to be fired. Aren't they going to start over after this abomination and trade Justin Fields somewhere and then take Caleb
they
Williams
might.
And Marvin? That's what you have to do. You have
what
to.
What about the kid at Washington?
Michael Penix Jr.?
Yes.
I don't think he's going to be number one.
I bore down on him the other day when their game against Oregon. And by the way, that was a fun game to watch. And Washington is fun. I just never see him.
Right.
Because they play so late most of the time. Now they'll be going to the Big Ten. But they got a unique stadium with those hangovers on both sides. That kid's really good.
He's a Heisman favorite at the moment.
Yeah. Well, I got a vote. I got an email the other day.
Oh, you did?
That. Yes, I did.
That form email.
That bugs the hell out of you.
Does it bug me?
No, it bugs
every
time I mention
bug
it,
them,
it makes you angry.
It should bother them.
And they said, "Well, we want to make sure you." One of the things they said is, "We just want to make sure you watch enough college football and that you're involved in the game." And they'll have their state coordinator reach out to me, and I understand they want that. So I make a point of trying to watch enough college football to satisfy. First of all, to have some integrity when it comes to voting for the Heisman.
Right.
But I had not seen Washington until the other day when they played Oregon. And by the way, what were those Oregon uniforms?
What
Did
were they
watch
wearing?
Any of it?
Of course not.
Of course not. You'll never vote for anything. You don't watch anything.
I voted for National League Player of the Week one time.
You don't watch anything. They were pure silver helmets. just a silver look. It was silver, white and silver.
That sounds awesome.
You never know what Oregon is going to do. The silver helmets look good, but they needed some color in the jersey. And it kind of had marks on stuff to make it look like it was dirt or something. I don't know what Oregon was going for.
Oregon's got a lot of combinations. Oregon can do that. They are Nike.
But the kid, Michael Penix Jr., is going to win the Heisman.
He very well could.
Because Caleb Williams, his coach doesn't support him.
What does his coach do?
Doesn't have a defense.
Okay, I thought you meant like vocally.
No, he doesn't have a defense. And so USC is going to be an afterthought, despite how talented Caleb Williams is.
Well, they still have to play Oregon and Washington and UCLA.
And they'll kill them. USC won't stand a chance in those games.
It's possible.
They can't stop anybody.
I understand. I get it.
Washington plays defense. Oregon plays defense.
It's hard to play defense.
But you better play some. You better play a semblance of defense.
I think if I was a college coach, I would recruit defense first and foremost to see if I could get the best defense in the country and then see what that would do for me. But I don't know if it would do anything because all these teams score. You can't win without scoring 35 a game.
Well, I'm going to talk. I'd love to have a symposium of high school coaches and talk to them about when their athletes show up, how many of them want to play defense? Because all the glitz and glamour is on the offensive side of the ball. Unless you're really something special, it's hard to make a name for yourself defensively.
Who would you say are the five most well-known defensive players in the NFL? Not best.
No, I couldn't even start. Frank Clark.
Sauce Gardner. It's tough.
It is tough. I'd have to.
Probably, Khalil Mack, maybe?
Is he still around?
Plays for somebody.
You don't even know who he plays
for. I think he plays for the Bears. Who does he play for?
I don't know.
He plays for the Chargers.
But I don't know.
Bosa would be on that list.
San Francisco has some guys. I can't think of them.
Yeah, that linebacker.
Aaron Donald.
Yeah. Most of these guys are the best.
But
I would say.
And I'd put Frank Clark in that category.
You would?
Yes. So anyway, we're jumping all over the place. Right now, you've got Washington ranked 5th and Oregon ranked 9th. Washington with the win over Oregon. You still got Oregon State at 12. I'm going through the Pac-12 because that conference is disintegrating. USC at 18. UCLA at 25. So still 5 teams ranked. Washington State getting votes. Not for much longer.
But they hung in for a little while.
Yeah, they did. So the Pac-12, you can make the case, next to the SEC, has been the strongest conference. Although, in the Big Ten, you've got Michigan 2, Ohio State 3, Penn State 7. And if you were to add Washington and Oregon to that mix, you'd have half of the top 10 in the Big Ten.
That's a pretty solid conference we got coming next year.
It is a solid conference. The SEC right now, its highest-ranked team is Alabama at 11. Oh, I'm sorry, outside
Georgia.
Of Georgia.
Yes.
But then Alabama at 11, Ole Miss at 13, Tennessee at 17, LSU 19, and Missouri hanging in there at 20. The SEC is not...
None of those teams excite
me. Not as dominant.
Not even close, no. Those teams, I mean, they're ranked by almost default because no one is really blowing the doors off this year in college football.
The Big 12 has Oklahoma at 6, Texas at 8. Those teams will be gone soon, joining the SEC. If they were gone now, the Big 12 would not have a ranked team.
That's bleak.
That is bleak. Utah is 14. They are coming to the Big 12. So I guess you'd you'd have Utah as your marquee program.
Well, Utah will be the marquee program coming in next year at least, right?
I guess.
If will you call they? Them marquee, I mean, who cares about Utah? Who cares about Utah?
Well, they're a good team.
Right, they're a good
team. And I neglected to mention them as part of the Pac-12, so you've got six teams out of the Pac-12 ranked in the top 25.
Right.
Which is pretty good.
Yeah, they're a good conference. They're finally getting some run when it's hard for them to get run because they play when no one watches.
I'll guarantee you we picked more Pac-12 games this year and none on the docket this week, but that we've ever picked because the teams are good.
Yeah, every week we get a pretty important game.
Now, yesterday you guys made fun of me for putting Oklahoma State, West Virginia among our picks.
Didn't really make fun of you.
I'm looking forward to
you
that.
Just called it an interesting game. And
I do think it's an interesting game.
I guess it. I mean, it has to be. I guess because it does have Big 12 implications. These teams are still in the thick of it early on in the Big 12 schedule.
Now, I have a conflict Saturday where I will have to be gone for an hour and a half, but I'll be watching.
What you got going on?
I got something over at League 42, the Passion Project.
That'll be fun.
You clowns over at KWCH ought to cover it sometime.
We will, I'm sure.
I don't know if you will. Our first guest is Colin Foster, the women's tennis coach at Wichita State. And the mission of this project, the Passion Project, is to instill in our kids the idea of how important it is to have passion. And
right.
Whatever that passion is, whether it's related to something you want to do in your career or just something that you wake up in the morning and you say, I'm passionate about this thing. For me, it was baseball. Baseball led to everything else. It was the path that directed me in life. It got me into journalism. It got me into baseball. It got me into sports. Now, I love all sports, but baseball has always been at the top of that list. So baseball was a passion I had, thanks to my father, and I used that passion to guide me throughout my entire life. Here I am at 68, and I'm still guided by my passion for baseball. So that's the message we want to send to kids. And I hope, you know, we're just starting this program. And I'm nervous as heck about it because I want a good turnout. And we've got a Bright Lights education program, and we've got a Bats and Badges program with area law enforcement and first responders. And we've got a full count program with credit unions that are going to help our kids and families with financial literacy. All kinds of stuff we're implementing in League 42.
Well, it's
I didn't plan to go into all that, but I might as well, right?
Might as well. It's all good work. It's a lot, I'm sure.
It's a lot. It's a lot. But we got a good group of people, and we're going to try to pull it off. And tomorrow at 1 o'clock, at the Leslie Rudd Learning Center, Colin Foster is going to talk about passion. All right, we are pursuing Steve Martin, the head football coach at Northwest High School. They have a big one tonight at home against Manhattan. Manhattan has also lost just once. They're the defending state champion in Class 6A. Manhattan's loss was to Washburn Rural. They have since pounded Emporia, Junction City, and Lansing. They certainly, with a win over Derby and Hayes as well this year, certainly back to chase another 6A title. 6A is going to be loaded.
Yeah, Manhattan's good. We know Northwest and East are good. Washburn Rural is in 6A. Gardner, Edgerton, there's a lot of really good teams, obviously.
Did you mention Derby?
I did.
I didn't hear you.
It was mixed in there.
Washburn Rural has beaten East by a point. They beat Manhattan by a touchdown, and they beat Junction City by three touchdowns. So they're a pretty good team as well. They've concluded their regular season. They won against Topeka West last night. They'll get it going in the playoffs. It says they play West, the 16 seed. Wouldn't they play North?
Is this where some teams don't go? I know they do that.
We gotta ask Joanna.
I know they do that in basketball where there's not enough teams to go around and somebody gets left out. So that might be the case here.
We'll need to ask Joanna Chadwick that question when she joins us a little bit later in the show. Wonder if Coach Martin forgot.
I don't know, but you better text him.
Well, you know I do.
This is
my OCD in full display.
You want me to text him instead?
No, you don't know him.
I don't.
Whatever you think you need to do.
I thought I knew him pretty well, but I guess if you want to text him, you can. I was going to ask Coach Martin when we get him on. He's got, obviously, Manhattan ending the season. This year he had Manhattan as the season ender last year, Hayes the year before that. So he's got these tough games at the end of the season. I imagine that puts them in a pretty good spot going into the postseason instead of a game that they just run over somebody.
Well, I don't know. I don't know what he'd say to that. Last year they had Manhattan and they lost 56-28.
Yeah.
In the regular season. Then they played them again in the playoffs and they lost 27-18. So they've got a couple losses in a row to Manhattan, and I'm sure that this is a big game. I'm sure that that he thinks about that.
Well, let's find out.
Coach Martin, what do you think about? How are you doing?
Hey, Bob. How are you? Thanks for having me on. How are you?
We're happy to have you on. Now, Manhattan, we were just talking about how good that program is. They're a one-loss team just like you are. The playoffs are beckoning. What does this game mean tonight?
Well, you know, what this game means is basically who's going to have home field advantage throughout the playoffs. So, pretty big deal. You know, you want to try to stay at home and play in the confines of the friendly environment. I know we do. You know, that's basically what you're playing for. You're playing for that seeding. You know, looking at some things, you know, depending on how things shake up in a couple of the other games that, you know, will have some shake up is that, you know, you could drop down to potentially a 6 or 7 seed. So that's a significant drop. Being the second seed, potentially drop down all the way to 7 seed. So instead of posting a 7 or 10 seed, you now become the 7 seed or 6 seed and go on the road to a very good 3 seeded or 2 seeded team. So huge implications off tonight.
So this is the third year in a row where you've had a big test at the end of the regular season. It was Manhattan again last year, and then I believe it was Hayes the year before that. So is that just how the schedule worked out? Do you make a point of trying to end the regular season with a challenge and get ready for the postseason? And how much does it help potentially to play a game like this going into the postseason?
Well, you know, I think there's a couple ways to worry. I mean, I don't think you want to be – you know, playing, going into the playoffs, a big game like this, I think it's just the way our schedule fit and what week we had open. And, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, we talked about beefing up our schedule and going out there and trying to play the best people that we can with our schedule that the City League allows us with our open weeks. And so when you have an opportunity to play a Manhattan team, you're going to want to do that because it's another test for your program and going into the playoffs. But I don't know if it's ideal playing the week before playoffs start or the play-in game. But, you know, we've had 3 years in a row, like you said, of playing that. You know, Hayes, we came out on the other end just fine when we played Hayes. And last year, you know, was really the first time we got tested after losing to Carroll. We didn't have a very close game. We didn't have any close games after week 1 of Carroll last week. And so, you know, this is a little bit different. You know, we had our loss to East on that last second field goal. And, you know, now you got to see if we corrected things from that week 4 or 5. So, you know, last year I compared a lot different is that, you know, we really didn't know how good we were because we were rolling through our schedule like it was last year at week 8. Now we feel like we have a pretty good handle of where we're at right now.
Steve Martin with us, head football coach, Wichita Northwest. So I used to be a columnist, and I tried to come up with ideas all the time, and I just thought of one. So my interpretation of high school football, and I don't know if you'll agree with this or not, I'm kind of floating it as a test balloon. There's the rich and the poor, and there's very little middle class. Am I on to something there? It seems like there's a lot of really good teams, a lot of really bad teams, and not a lot of just average okay teams.
Well, I mean, if you go look at the 6A side and of the Western side and the 5A side, I think your hypothesis is correct, because you got, you know, you could go from 6A is basically, it could go 1 through 10 seed being 5-3 or 6-2 or 7-1 and 8-0. And you look at 5A West, you could say the same thing, maybe down to the 11 seed. So, you know, you might have a point there. I think it's kind of almost feast or famine, like you're saying. So I think it's a good observation.
Well, I feel better about that. Thank you.
Well, there have to be average teams just by law of averages, right? It has to balance out somehow. I'm curious, Coach, about it was several weeks ago, but you talked about kind of figuring out where you were based on a more difficult schedule and maybe even that last-second loss to East. What was kind of the regrouping period? I don't know if that's how you'd put it, but after that loss, what was kind of the focus for your team and kind of, like you said, just figuring out what you were?
Well, for us, I mean, I'm being real honest, Bob. I think you and me talked after we had Bishop Carroll, the Bishop Carroll game, and, you know, we won 58-7, and everybody is, you know, proclaiming us the next big thing, you know, and we're sitting there going, you know, we knew that Carroll was a little bit down. We didn't know they were going to have the season they were having right now, being 3-4. I think, I don't know if Bishop Carroll had ever had a losing record since I was born in 81. I don't know their history in that, but I mean, for me growing up, I don't remember Bishop Carroll ever having a losing record. And so, you know, for them to drop like that, you know, I thought at the time, you know, our kids included, you know, I thought we have a chance to be very, very special. And, you know, you go out and you beat Heights, and you have the comeback against Capen where, you know, we very dominated the second half there after not playing well in the first half. And I think you start believing in yourself and you start thinking a little bit more highly of yourself. And, you know, going into the East game, we probably felt like, you know, this was going to be just another Northwest East game where we win by 30, 40 points and we get out the door and we just get on a roll. And, you know, but that's a credit to those guys. You know, Coach Ockpon has done a tremendous job of building up that roster over there. And, you know, they have a legitimate shot to go make a very deep run this year. And, you know, they did a great job. We got out coached and we got outplayed. Pretty, you know, I'm not going to make any excuses. They were the better team that night. And so what that told us, we had to get back to work and we got to see what was maybe not good in our scheme offensively and defensively. And we were able to make those corrections. So, you know, we always talk about, you know, learning environments and be able to learn from mistakes. And, you know, if there is such thing as a good loss, I will definitely take that loss because I think our guys have been recentered and I hope that carries over to tonight because, you know, we've had three games, so we really get better and correct what we've been doing wrong. And I think it's going to show tonight how we play against Manhattan.
Northwest and Manhattan tonight at Northwest. Steve Martin, the Northwest Grizzlies head coach. We were talking earlier in the show, Steve, about the athletes in football and how we perceive them to be heavily focused on the offensive side. You've got a great offense. You have had for several years now. It looks like your defense is much improved this year. Do kids want to play defense in today's football?
I'd say no. You know, because if you look at society and you look at everything, everybody wants to be throwing the touchdowns. Everybody wants to play quarterback. Everybody wants to be that running back, you know. No one wants to be that offensive lineman. And, you know, and no one wants to go over on the defensive side of the ball and not get their name read. So, you know, it's definitely a sport that's mocking society in a pretty selfish society that we live in right now.
Great answer. I that's another column I would write if I was still doing that.
Well, you got the money quote right there.
Yeah.
Well, why not? I mean, no one covers local sports in the papers anymore anyway. Might as well jump back in and give you something to do, Bob.
Hey, thanks for being on the show. We always appreciate
you. Appreciate you guys.
Thanks. All right, Steve Martin, the head football coach at Wichita Northwest. We'll come back and talk some more football at just a little bit higher level. Drew Dallas, head football coach at Hutchinson Community College. They are unbeaten and ranked number one in the country. Drew Dallas, our guest next.